Thank you, Bob, for those wonderful, warm remarks and thoughtful comments that I think really does set the stage for tonight. It is good to be home again, and it does feel like home to be here. In fact, I walked around Burton Judson this afternoon. I was master there for 4 years and lived there, and it was just great to be there. So it is now my great pleasure to call to order the 2051st stated meeting of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. So let me not only thank those of you who are here, and a wonderful turnout it is, but also this event is being live streamed to the public, but Academy members all over the country. At the Academy's annual induction in October, we welcomed 6 faculty members from the University of Chicago into our membership. And with their election, there are now 270 members of the Academy from the greater Chicago area, 156 who are associated with the University of Chicago. And it's great to see so many of you here tonight. Our membership's becoming increasingly involved in the work of the Academy, not just by organizing programs like this one, but by serving as members of our advisory committees, participating in the preparation of policy reports, and writing for our quarterly journal, Daedalus. The Academy was founded in 1780, as most of you know, by John Adams, James Bowdoin, John Hancock, and other leaders who helped establish the United States. But in the midst of the American Revolution, they were not just founding a society to honor each other. They believed the key to America's long-term strength and survival, in the words of our charter, was to cultivate every art and science which may tend to advance the interest, honor, dignity, and happiness of a free, independent, and virtuous people. So from the very beginning, the Academy's purpose has been to bring its members together who can contribute to what they called useful knowledge. Our 5,000 members and 600 foreign honorary members are from all academic disciplines, but beyond that, the performing arts, business, philanthropy, public affairs, journalism, the whole range of human endeavor represented in our membership. Our ability to draw on experts from around the world and from every discipline and profession is the Academy's biggest asset in providing thoughtful, independent, and trusted advice to the nation and beyond. And I think you can perhaps empathize with the fact that we feel, let's say, the obligation, the burden now almost as never before. This is an important time for the Academy. A recent Academy report on science and engineering research entitled Restoring the Foundation is a good example of the work we do. The report encourages a greater emphasis on long-range planning in the area of science and engineering. It urges funders and policymakers to provide more support for basic research, research that may not yield immediate results, but that may ultimately prove transformative. Several of the report's recommendations have found their way into legislation that was passed by Congress in December and signed by President Obama into law last month, including reaffirming the value of peer review, reducing administrative burdens on university researchers, and streamlining application processes for federal research grants. So here's an example. I was asked at the reception, can I give an example of where an Academy report made a difference? And here's an example of where our recommendations were, and we testified before the Senate Commerce Committee that was drafting the bill. The Academy also has a deep interest in higher education. Last year, we released a report looking at the challenges faced by public research universities, great universities that have been suffering dramatic cuts in state funding and which need to find a new financial model, even as they hope for continued support from public sources. We have another commission chaired by the head of the Spencer Foundation, Mike McPherson, here in Chicago, looking at how Americans are receiving their post-secondary education, examining the whole range of options, not just University of Chicago, but community colleges, for-profit schools, online providers, trade schools, the whole spectrum. rising costs, how students finance their education, challenges of access, fair access to students of diverse backgrounds, and the match between what people are learning, skills, dispositions, and the world they're going to live in and work in over the next 20 years and beyond are all central topics. The Commission put out a publication entitled A Primer on the College Student Journey. If you have a chance to get it, I don't know that we have enough copies here, but go online and you can get access to it. And it gives a pretty good baseline picture for how Americans are getting their post-secondary education these days. Next week in Washington, we'll release another Academy Commission report, this one on the state of language learning. No surprise, not very robust, and it needs to be a lot better, and we have a series of recommendations for improving. Not all the Academy's work comes in the form of these commissions or long-term projects. Last year, we started something we call an exploratory fund, and that's to enable members, any of you, to write me a simple letter and say, here's a topic I'd like to talk to other members about. Could have a policy focus, but also some have been on more academic issues like preserving intellectual heritage in a digital age. Our very first meeting was organized by Chicago's own John Levy, chair of the Legal Services Corporation, and Harvard Law Dean Martha Minow. John is chair of the Legal Services Corporation, while it still exists, and is worried about the fact that 80% of low-income Americans who apply for legal assistance are turned away because we just don't have the people power to service their needs. And so we thought we'd have a meeting of a few legal aid advocates, but word got around, and we had chief judges and leaders from many states, Texas, Oregon, Ohio, Hawaii, New Jersey, New York, California, all coming to together to say, this is a problem, let's get after it. And so a follow-on project is now coming. Other exploratory meetings are looking at the growing disconnect between area and global studies, the future of jazz, the need for a new international norm on the responsibility to protect cultural heritage, think Palmyra. So just to give you a sense of the range of work that your Academy is doing. And perhaps most relevant to tonight's program is a new Academy initiative on the public face of science, which will address various aspects of the complex and evolving relationship between scientists and the public. This is a multi-year project, and its purpose is to understand, examine how the public develops trust or mistrust in science and the scientific process. President Zimmer's anecdote earlier, I think, is a perfect illustration of the kind of question that we're going to be looking at. There will be roundtable discussions with Academy members, I hope some here, and practicing journalists, as well as a series of shorter studies on how scientists are consulted during specific public policy decisions, in court cases, in natural disasters, and all the rest. Concern for science has been called into sharp focus by recent events, and the role of facts, or should I say alternative facts, is shaping in shaping public opinion. We really need to understand this process. And so tonight's program, Communicating Scientific Facts in the Age of Uncertainty, could not come at a more opportune time. We look forward to learning from our three panelists, all members of the American Academy, Bob Rosner, who serves on the Academy's Council, Fumi Ulupati, who serves on our International Committee, and Skip Lupia, a valued advisor to this initiative. And Eric Isaacs will now provide some additional background on tonight's program and introduce our speakers. I think probably everybody here knows he's a professor of physics at the university and executive vice president for research, innovation, and national laboratories. So Eric, take it away.